them together. Let's all stand. Hymn number 469, if you need the words, Christ for me. Yes, it's Christ for me. Hymn 469.
Christ for me. Yes, it's Christ for me. He's my Savior, my Lord and King. I'm so happy I shout and sing. Christ for me. Yes, it's Christ for me. Every day as I go my way, it is Christ for me.
All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer, please. Our Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day and for what you've given us, Lord, for the opportunity for us to be in church here this morning. And I pray that everything that is done here would honor and glorify thy name. Speak to hearts now in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's take our hymn books, please. Hymn number 25. Hymn number 25, How Firm a Foundation. How firm a foundation, ye saints of the Lord. Hymn number 25. Sing it out from the bottom of your hearts, please.
How firm a foundation, ye saints of the Lord.
Hold up. We're good? We're not good.
I can't hear you.
You can't hear me? I don't think you want to hear him. Let's try that again. All right. This has been a while. Please, how great thou art. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder, hymn number 34.
O Lord my God, when
may be seated. Give me a chance to catch my breath. I like having Nathan up here, don't you? All right. Well, let's think about what's going on in the life and ministry of the Spring Creek Baptist Church. Don't forget, on May the 26th, we are having a potluck meal right after the service. Please bring your favorite cover dish. Just bring something. Surprise us. Amen. And bring enough to feed your family plus one more. Also, June the 24th through the 27th, we'll be having our Vacation Bible School. I'm going to be honest with you. I'm looking forward to Vacation Bible School this year. I want to see God do something here in the lives of young people here at the Spring Creek Baptist Church, don't you? And I want to see that, so let's pray towards that end, but let's also work towards that end. Yes. All right, did you all hear that? We still need donations for snacks and food, etc. Monetary donations, so. Still, if you're able to do that, please help us with that. There will be a meeting following this morning's service over here on the orchestra side of the auditorium. It'll be quick, but we want to just talk about some things for Vacation Bible School, work on getting on the same page. Don't forget about these things. And let's go ahead and take our hymn books, please. Oh, by the way, do we have any visitors here this morning? Any visitors? All right. Let's take our hymn books, please. Open up the hymn number. I'm sorry. Don't take your hymn books. I'm going to skip things again. Pray for the choir as they sing When We All Get to Heaven. Number 78, please. Hymn number 78, Higher Ground. Let's all stand, please. Hymn number 78, I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day. Hymn number 78 on that first verse, please.
I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day, still praying as I'm onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground.
Number 22, hymn 22, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. Hymn 22, we'll sing that first verse, and then we'll take a moment to greet each other. Hymn 22, please, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine.
Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine.
Take a moment, put on our best smiles this morning, and shake each other's hand, please. right, as we find our seats, let's sing that last verse, perfect submission, all is at rest. Verse number 3, hymn 22.
Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story.
Thank you. You may be seated. The Patch the Pirates are going to sing our special for us this morning. Young people, do it unto the Lord. Let's have the ushers come up. All right, if we can have all the ushers come up, please. We'll take up our offering. All right. All right, Kevin, would you lead us in a word of prayer for the offering? Thank you.
words, send a revival, and let it begin in me. Amen. Amen. Let's take our Bibles, please, and open up to the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. We'll continue on our thoughts that we're doing on Sunday mornings on a good report. These are a series of good reports that God gave. And He gave these good reports because of the faith of these people. Not because of their skill set, not because of their knowledge, but because of their faith. Faith is about looking unto Jesus. These are people that kept their eyes on the Lord no matter what they were facing in life. We think that, you know, if I'm a Christian, everything in life is going to be smooth sailing. That's not true. But because we're a Christian, we can keep our eyes on Christ even during the trials, and we can see what He's doing in our lives in the midst of our trials. And we'll find that He can even get us through the valley of the shadow of death. And by the way, when you read Psalm 23, there's a table that's prepared on the other side of that valley. So no matter what we're going through in life, we need to keep our eyes on the Lord. Let's look at Hebrews chapter 11 and verse number 8. If you're able to, please stand for the reading of the Word of God. Verse number 8, by faith Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, obeyed. There's a lot in that word. He obeyed. And he went out not knowing whether he went. No debate. God, I'll do this if. He just obeyed. By faith he sojourned in the land of promise as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked for a city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God. There's a lot in that. This morning, I want us to think about the good report of Abraham. Mike, would you lead us in a word of prayer for the message?
Dear Lord, thank you so much for this morning. Lord, thank you for bringing us together. As we gather around your word now, and Lord, as the pastor preaches, may we open our hearts, may we open our minds, may we put away the distractions that may come during this time. But Lord, we pray that we would have just a wonderful blessing, that you'd meet with us in a very special way.
Yes.
Preaching of your word. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. The good report of Abraham. I like to see this chapter, Hebrews chapter 11, as the great hall of faith. And enshrined within its walls are the great heroes of the faith. And God uses this chapter to give us the good reports of these individuals. And thus far, we have seen Abel and his saving faith. We have seen Enoch and his satisfying faith. We have seen Noah and his stirring faith, and this morning, Abraham is our next hero, and we're going to see that Abraham, listen, had a submissive faith. He simply obeyed. He obeyed. I want to take a moment before we get into his submissive faith. I want to get to know Abraham a little bit. So let's go back to Genesis chapter 11. Genesis chapter 11. I want to begin reading in verse 27. Genesis chapter 11 and verse 27. I'll give you a moment. The Word of God says, "Now these are the generations of Terah. Terah begat Abram," and we know that to be Abraham, "Nahor, and Haran begat Lot." So this verse also introduces to us another character in the life of Abraham, and that's his nephew, that's Lot. Look at verse 28 and 29. And Haran died before his father Terah in the land of his nativity in Ur of the Chaldees. And Abram and Nahor took them wives. The name of Abram's wife was Sarai. And the and the name of Nahor's wife is Milcah, the daughter of Haran, the father of Milcah, and the father of Iscah. Look at verse 31. Well, look at verse 30. But Sarai was barren. She had no child. Of course, that also affected Abraham. And Terah took Abram, his son, and Lot, the son of Haran, his son's son, and Sarai, his daughter-in-law, his son Abram's wife, and they went out. They went forth with them from Ur of the Chaldees to go into the land of Canaan, and they came unto Haran and dwelt there, and the days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Haran. Now, verse 31, it tells us something interesting. It says that they dwelt there. Terah was the head of the home, and he was leading his family to the land of Canaan, and they stopped at Haran, which is near Turkey. I do not know why they stopped there. Perhaps it was because of health reasons, because Haran dies, or Terah dies in verse number 32. But really our goal this morning is to look at Abraham and his submissive faith. It appears, and this is just speculation on my part, that Abraham picked up where his dad left off. But we see him here living a faith life. He had his eyes focused on the Lord, and he's instructed to go to the land of Canaan. He simply obeyed. We sing the hymn to trust and obey, for there's no other way. Every person in Hebrews chapter 11, we could say, had a submissive faith. If we are not submissive to God, we cannot say that we have faith in God. Faith requires submission. You'll notice in our text in Hebrews chapter 11 that he obeyed and went out not knowing whether he went. He did not need all of the details. We want all of the details. We want to make sure that our itinerary is planned out. Now look, if you're going out of town on a vacation, you may want to have an itinerary. But Abraham wasn't going on vacation. Abraham was literally uprooting not just his life, but the lives of the people in his family. And they were leaving a place that they called home for so many years. And they were obeying God. Abraham had a submissive faith. There are three things that I want us to look at this morning that will allow us to see his submissive faith. And I would encourage us to have the Lord, ask the Lord to look, to shine a light in our lives to show us where we're not submissive, to show us where we are not trusting God, to show us perhaps we're asking God to show us an itinerary when God just wants us to step out by faith. Number one, I want you to notice the call to go. Abraham had a call to go. So the scripture says in verse number 8, by faith Abraham, when he was called to go out unto a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, obeyed. Can I say that there in that verse it does talk about a blessing from God, but the blessing from God did not come until Abraham yielded to the call on his life to go from the place that he was. We want the blessing of God on our lives, but God only blesses obedience. He does not bless disobedience. This morning, I had the opportunity and the privilege to speak to our teenagers this morning, and I was trying to point out some principles on staying right with God. And by the way, even adults need these principles. But many times, we seek God's blessing, but we do not meet the qualification for God's blessing. What is the qualification according to this verse? It's obedience. We want God to bless us, then we need to obey God. We need to keep God's word. We need to do that which God wants us to do in our lives. You'll notice back in Genesis chapter 12, here was the specific call to go. He says in Genesis chapter 12 and verse number 1, "Now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of," what is that? "Thy country, and from thy kindred." What's kindred? It's family. "And from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee." Three times we see the word "thy." I want you to go from your home. I want you to go from your family. I want you to leave where you're familiar with. I want to leave where you have heritage. I see that word "thy." This was a personal sacrifice on Abraham, on his part. Following God always costs something. I want you to leave your country. I know that there are servicemen here that have done that, and we thank you for that. But you came back. Abraham left never to come back. I want you to get away from your family. Do you think Abraham loved his family? His aunts, his uncles, his cousins? I want you to get away from where you have heritage. Why do you do that? I believe because at that point in his life, Abraham was surrounded by people who did not worship God. It's one of the reasons, I think. He would have been different. They were not worshiping God the way that Abraham worshiped God. They would not have understood some things. They would have been a hindrance to him. And God is saying, I want you to separate yourself from them. I want you to see what the Bible says in Psalm number 1, please. You see, his call to go was not just to leave home. Not just to leave a geographical location. Do not see this call to go to just leave at some place. Look what the Bible says in Psalm number 1. "Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful." There is a digression that happens in that verse. It goes from standing to sitting, excuse me, let me back up, from walking to standing to sitting. We're to have nothing to do with ungodly things. We'll start to say, well, what's wrong with that? That means we're just standing there. We start to consider things that God says no to. And then we'll sit down and we'll allow those things to influence our lives. How do we avoid that? I think Abraham's call to go was more about Abraham getting closer to God. I'm trying to make a biblical case for separation in a Sunday morning service. Let's understand what biblical separation is and the purpose behind it. We always look at 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 6. We'll say, what's wrong with such and such? You know, this morning I was teaching the kids to stay away from doubtful things. We say, oh, I've got liberty to do such and such. Just because we have an opportunity to do something doesn't mean we have an obligation to do something. Just because we may have liberty doesn't mean it's the right thing to do. And the reason we practice and we play with doubtful things is because we don't practice biblical separation. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse number 14. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? When you think of righteousness, who do you think of? God. And what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial? When you think of Belial, who do you think of? Satan. Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? There are a lot of things that happen in church in the name of Christianity that's not biblical at all. It's because we do not have a proper understanding of biblical separation. Can I give you a simple picture of separation? Can I do that this morning? Can I use your two kids? Boys, Nathan, Levi, come up here. All right. I want you, we're going to pretend this young man, don't let this get to your head. Okay? Can you promise me not to let this get to your head? Okay. He's honest. This one's the devil. Don't let this get to your head. Let's practice Levi. Let's pretend Levi's God. Okay? Don't let that get to your head. Nathan, I'm sorry. Forgive me. It takes me a while with names. You've been over to my house and I fed you. I should know this. All right. I'll call you Bob. You're God today. This one's the devil. Or the world. Okay? I'm just an average Christian. We think separation is about being equally apart from the world. You'll notice in our scripture it talked about Christ. Separation is about being close to God. It is from the world unto the Lord. I believe that Abraham's call to go was about getting closer to God. It's not about seeing how close I can get to the world without actually getting close to the world. Because honestly, the further closer I get to the world, the further from Him I'm away. He has not moved. God has not changed. We change. We allow things in our lives that ought not be in our lives, and God is not pleased with those things. That's why He calls us to go, to get closer to Him. Separation is about protecting our testimony. It is about protecting our walk with God. I want us all to be gripped with the philosophy, the biblical philosophy, that whatever we do it unto the Lord to please God. And worldliness does not please Him. That's why certain music should not be allowed in church. That's why there's certain things that in the name of worship that happens today, it ought not be in the house of God. And by the way, listen to me, I'm going to pet the cat backwards this morning. If it does not belong in the house of God, it should not belong in our houses. We think it's okay to allow things in our home, but keep it out of the church. Whatever happens in the house will eventually happen here at the church. That's what happens. That's why there's so much modern stuff that goes on in churches today that should not happen in God's house, because no one has answered the call to go get closer to God. Thank you, boys. Appreciate it. He had the call to go. And what did he do? The Bible says he obeyed. He left home. He left his family, save Lot. That's an important thing to think about, by the way. He left where he had heritage, where he had roots. God uprooted him to bring Abraham to God. It's not about the geography. If God uproots you geographically, he's not just moving you geographically, he's moving you closer to him. We need to see what God is doing. He had a call to go. Number two, this is also important. I want you to notice the castle he was in. The castle he lived in, back in our text in Hebrews chapter 11. By faith, he sojourned in the land, as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. Genesis chapter 12, verse number 8, says that he pitched his tent. That was his castle. A man's home is his castle, right? He lived in a tent. A tent is easily moved. He was willing to do without in order to obey. He did not allow his earthly possessions or earthly pursuits to keep him from obedience. Can I say, if we hold on to something and something is keeping us from obeying God, God could take that away from us. He lived in a tent. A tent is easily moved. A tent is easily destroyed. He trusted in God's protection. Storms can knock over a tent, but he understood what the Scripture teaches in Psalm 18 and verse number 2. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my strength in whom I will trust, my buckler, the horn of my salvation, and my high tower. He trusted God to be his defense. He did not rely on the possessions that he had. And Abraham was a wealthy man, but he did not rely on earthly possessions. He relied on God to be his defense. He lived in a tent. Now listen to this. That tells me something about Sarah. She was willing. Ladies, I understand, different day, different era. How many ladies would be willing to live in a tent? You may be somebody that's willing to camp out. Some of you like to camp out. My idea of camping involves an air conditioner, a shower. Huh? That's right. Something that says Holiday Inn Express on it. Listen. I could do an RV. Because it has an air conditioning, it has heat in the winter time. For 8 months, we lived in a camper. She lived in a tent. This tells me something about her and something about Abraham. They were willing to live in something temporary and something that could be destroyed in order to obey God. Neither of them were a hindrance on each other. And that happens a lot of times in couples where one hinders the other from obeying God. They both were willing to live in a tent. But may I say, a man can only go as far as his wife will let him. There's truth in that. She was his supporter. She said, if my husband is willing to live in a tent to obey God, then I'm going to follow. And I'm going to live in a tent so that he and I can obey God together. I want you to think about the site of his castle. He sojourned in a land of promise. To sojourn, that means he picked up his tent and he went over here and he put down the stakes. But then he picked up the tent and he went over there and he put down some stakes. And then God moved him. And God moved him. He sojourned. He was willing to go where God would have him go. He was right where God led him. He understood that where God leads, God provides. And that provision is not just a monetary provision. Have you ever been in a place where God stops speaking to you? That is a sad place to be. There was a time in my life that I was in a place where God did not speak to me. I read my Bible. I prayed. I went to church. I did all those things. I did all those things. But God stopped speaking to me. Provision is not just monetary. Provision is also about being in the presence of God so that God could speak to you. And if we do not hear God's voice, we ought to miss God's voice. You say, how do I get that back? You go back to where you left God. God hasn't moved. If God leads, God will provide. God's provision is not just monetary. It is about hearing His voice. I'm not talking about audibly. You know when God speaks to you. I'm talking about spiritual blessings for a moment. Let's stop thinking about worldly possessions as God's blessings. And if God blessed you with a new truck, praise the Lord for that. When was the last time God spoke to you? When was the last time God moved you, led you to do something, and you obeyed? We want God to keep speaking to us. We keep obeying Him. I want you to quickly notice number three, the city He looked for. The Bible says, for He looked for a city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God. A tent does not have a foundation. But He wasn't looking for that. His eyes were towards heaven. His eyes were towards that mansion that has a permanent and eternal foundation. The earth does not have the foundation that He was looking for. We put so much root down here that God has a hard time using us. Don't put roots down here. Lay up your treasures in heaven, where moth nor rust doth not corrupt. Work towards heaven. Live towards heaven. Don't hang on to the things of this earth. Have a submissive faith. Be willing to say yes to God. Whatever it is that He would have you to do, you just say yes to. It may require a geographic change. It may require a change in our lives and how we conduct ourselves and the things that we do. A change. Why do we do that? Is it to please the preacher or is it to please God? We ought to do these things because our eyes are looking towards that city. Our eyes should always be towards heaven. We don't want to be so earthly minded, we're of no heavenly good. Christians are often accused of being too heavenly minded, they're of no earthly good, and that's wrong. If you are heavenly minded, you will be earthly good. God will use you here, but there are so many distractions on this earth that this is where we look to. And our eyesight should always be towards there. What are we looking at? Where was Abraham looking? Why was he willing to obey? Why was he willing to leave family and home and heritage, all of those things? Why was he willing to do that? Because he was looking there. He was okay living in a tent. He was okay to pick up stakes and move the tent somewhere else. He was willing to do whatever it was that God wanted him to do because he was looking for a city whose builder and maker is God. And today, Abraham is enjoying the fruit of that decision to live a submissive faith. Abraham's not a fairy tale. Abraham is not some nice little Sunday school story we teach the Sunday school kids. He was a man that literally lived, that had that principle in his life that I am going to obey God. I am not going to drive stakes too far down into this earth. If God wants me to move, I'm going to move. If God wants me to change, I'm going to change. Whatever it is that God wants me to do, that's what I'm going to do because I'm looking for something that is going to last for eternity, and that's what Abraham is doing right now. He is in heaven enjoying the fruits of that decision. And today we have to instill within us principles to live a faith life based on the fact that we have to do that same thing and look to heaven. We have to see what Abraham saw. Oh, we'll be mocked. That's okay. Be mocked. I heard that this week that our church has been criticized on Facebook. I don't care. I really don't care. You know what that makes me want to do? Get some more tracks, go out and knock on some doors and just do it again. I can handle a phone call. Just so you know, I can handle a phone call. If we stopped going soul winning, that's because our eyes are here. Right. This world one day is going to pass away. It's going to be burnt up in a fervent heat. But if we go out with some gospel tracts and we knock on doors and we tell people about Jesus, that means our eyes are where Abraham's eyes were. We're not perfect, but I sure do want to please God. I want to keep my eyes. And there are a lot of things in this world that distracts me, just like you. We just need to determine to keep our eyes on that heavenly city whose builder and maker is God. Have a submissive faith. Just obey God. You don't need a Bible college degree to obey God, do you? You don't need to have some super skill set and a slick resume to obey God. What do? Obey God? You just do it. You read the Bible, it says that. Okay, I'm not going to debate it. I'm not going to argue with it. I'm just going to do it. Just going to do it. Let's just determine to have a submissive faith, and God blesses that submissive faith, by the way. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Will you join me in prayer, please? Our Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day and for what you've given us, Lord, and for the opportunity for us to be in church here this morning. Lord, I know that there are areas in our lives that we're not as submissive as we should be. Lord, we pray that you would help us to be submissive. Moody, I believe it was, that pointed out that the world has yet to see what God can do with somebody who's totally committed to them, to you. I believe that you want us to be submissive. Help us to obey you. Not to argue, not to debate, but just obey you. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Every head bowed, every eye closed. The piano's going to begin playing. If the Lord spoke to your heart this morning, the altar's open. Let's all stand. Let's be submissive to God. Be submissive. Today, the world says, what about my rights? What about God's? All he wants us to do is to be obedient. He bought us. He paid for us. Just wants us to be obedient to him. Perhaps this morning I'm speaking to somebody that left God off somewhere because you disobeyed and God stopped speaking to you. Let me encourage you to go back to where you disobeyed God and pick up on being obedient. Just be obedient. God blesses obedience. The Lord spoke to your heart here this morning. Do not forget about the afternoon service at 1 o'clock. I'm going to be preaching from Galatians on be not be weary in well-doing. Times we're going to want to quit, but Paul encouraged that church, you just keep going on. Do not be weary in well-doing. So please stick around for that. Don't forget the Vacation Bible School meeting. We'll give a few moments because I know there's people in other places on the property here. But let's go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer. Yes, sir.
I just felt like saying this morning. While they're criticizing us on Facebook, well, they were criticizing Jesus Christ when he was on the cross and he was doing it for them. Mm-hmm. You keep leading us. We're going to keep following. Thankful to have you. Thankful.
Amen, sir. Would you dismiss us in a word of prayer, please?
Dear Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this particular day that you have made with your precious hands. We thank you for being with us in this day and allowing us to be in it. We thank you for allowing us to be here, gathered together, to be your church. Not an individual church, but a family church, a church of your family. We thank you for the word we heard today. We thank you for our preacher, Sunday school teacher, and all those who supported it. And we thank you for every person that has come here today to be part of the family. The world does not teach us these things. The world tries to guide us away. As we come here to support each other. We come here to honor you and to be obedient to you. In the name of your Son, we ask you to be with us as we depart. Bring us back again in a little while for our afternoon gathering. In the name of your Son, who is our Lord and who is our Savior. In Jesus' name, we pray to you. In the Spirit, we come to you. And we still remember you and we love you, God, always and forever. Amen.
Amen. Be good. Be safe.